We'll cover an important inspection you'll do before every flight, the pre-flight inspection. To accomplish the pre-flight, or any inspection accurately, you'll need to have the checklist along as a reference. Now, there are several approaches to checklist use. You may either preview several items and then accomplish them, check each item as it is accomplished, or review the checklist after accomplishing several items. The important thing to remember here is use the checklist. Open your checklist now to the pre-flight check and follow along. As you approach the aircraft, you can check for FOD and other general condition items such as missing panels, tie-down chains, fuel or oil spills, fire bottles, or any other major items. For the most part, the pre-flight concerns itself with the cockpit area. First, ensure the canopy down lock handle is forward to lock the canopy in the raised position during pre-flight. Then, visually check that the safety pin for the canopy jettison T-handle is installed on the left side of the cockpit. You'll notice there are red streamers on all the aircraft safety pins. Don't just look for these red streamers, though, because they can sometimes separate from the pins. Some students have trouble with this pin, but it's really quite simple. The straight portion of the pin goes in the hole, with the curved part sliding underneath. If you don't think the pin is installed properly when you get out to the jet, leave it alone. Call maintenance and let them handle it. Next, visually check that a hand grip safety pin with a streamer is installed in each seat, as shown here. Now you're ready to check the ejection seat itself. Check that two ground safety pins are removed from the seat. These pins are used to safety the seat during maintenance. Check that one pin is removed from under the plexiglass inspection window in the seat, and that the other is removed from the back of the seat. These two pins can only be removed by maintenance. If any pin is left installed, the entire egress system for that seat will be inoperative. Remember, don't just look for the streamer, look for the pin. Check the seat man separator strap for cuts. The strap guide should be snapped down and the strap should not be twisted. Now ensure that the cushion is secured to the seat. Should the cushion slide forward in flight, it could interfere with stick movement. At this point, it's a good idea to ensure that you have an adequate number of parachute spacers to help support your parachute. If they aren't already in the aircraft, you can get some from maintenance. Now inspect the shoulder harness and seat belt, as you did with the seat man separator. The fuzz appearing on the strap surface and along the edge are broken ends of strap fibers. A small amount of wear is expected, but if it looks excessive, have maintenance check it out. Check up here to make sure the canopy ground safety pin is not installed. Check the quick disconnect plate on the left side of both seats, as shown here. The couplings should be safety wired together. Improperly mated couplings will result in failure of the canopy to jettison during ejection. At this point in the pre-flight inspection, as technique, place your parachute in the aircraft and prepare the straps for easy entry. The checklist now directs you to check the Form 781, also known as the aircraft forms. As a technique, most instructors check the forms when first arriving out at the jet, since they tell you the condition of your aircraft. Before you start going through them, though, ensure you have the correct forms for your aircraft tail number. Since a program text covers how to check the 781, we won't discuss it in detail here. After checking the forms, you're ready to continue with the pre-flight inspection. Check the oxygen system as listed in the checklist. Normally, a fully serviced system will read 425 plus or minus 25 PSI. Next, unlock the flight controls and move the lock away from the stick. Reach over and check that the landing gear handle is down. If it isn't in the full down position, don't touch it. Call maintenance. Next, check that the access zipper for the canopy D-clutch T-handle is closed. To complete the pre-flight check, open the access door and check that the external canopy circuit switch, shown here on the right, is in the internal position. Then close and secure the access door. Now that you've completed the pre-flight check, you're ready to start the exterior inspection, which we'll cover in the next program. This program will take you through the interior check, explaining how to accomplish the checks listed in your T-37 checklist. After you complete the exterior inspection, go ahead and strap in as you were taught in aviation physiology. Then get your checklist out so you can refer directly to it as you complete the check. You should also use your checklist to follow along during this program. The first item is control lock stowed. Swing it down and stow it as shown here. Make certain the control lock pin is secure in the locking bracket. Next, you should check to see that all the required pubs for your flight are on board the aircraft. They should be stowed in the map compartment in the center console. Lock the door after checking them. The third item directs you to check your leg and chest straps, safety belt, and shoulder harness for proper condition. Look also for cuts or frayed edges. Be sure you're strapped in properly with zero delay and gold key connected. Your zippers should be closed and make sure that the emergency oxygen cylinder is connected. Check that your helmet chin strap is fastened and adjusted to a snug fit under your chin. Challenge your IP to also check the items listed in step 3 of the checklist. Many IPs prefer that you wait until the battery is on to accomplish the challenge and response items so that you can use the interphone to talk. At this point, there is a warning that we need to address. To permit clean separation from the seat during ejection, the gold key must be outside the parachute harness and not caught on any equipment. Also, you should connect, release, and reconnect the safety belt to ensure proper operation. Now check for positive locking of the belt by pulling up on the release handle without depressing the black portion of the handle. Now you're ready to check for proper seat adjustment. Each time you fly, your position in the aircraft should be the same. Your instructor will give you some references you can use to adjust your seat to the same height each flight. To adjust the seat, first ensure that the hand grip safety pin is installed. Then check that the area underneath the seat is clear of obstructions. If an object was left under a hand grip, inadvertent movement could result when the seat is lowered. To actually adjust the seat, lift up on this lever and allow the seat to move up and down the rails by putting more or less weight on the seat. Use your legs to change body weight in the seat. Lower the lever when you're in the proper position. Here's another warning. After adjusting the seat to the proper height, check that the seat catches are engaged. If the seat is not locked, G-loads in flight may cause it to move or prevent a safe ejection. Jiggle your seat up and down while simultaneously holding down on the adjustment lever to satisfy yourself it is locked in. Now adjust the rudder pedals. When you rotate the rudder pedal crank, it causes the pedals to move closer or further away depending on which way you crank it. The rudder pedals should be in a position that will allow full rudder travel without having to completely extend your leg. When the pedal is completely depressed, you should have some bend in your leg. If you're in the aircraft with your IP, be careful as you check the flight controls for free and proper movement, or you could bang his knee with the stick. So before you begin moving the stick around, Advise your instructor to keep his knees clear. Push the stick to the left and look at the left aileron. It should be up. Then look to the right. The right aileron should be down. Push the stick to the right and look to the right. The right aileron should be up. The left aileron should be down. Now pull the stick back and look over your left shoulder. The trailing edge of the horizontal stabilizer should come up with the control stick pulled back. If you can't see the trailing edge very well, check the position of the elevator horn on the outside of the horizontal stabilizer. Finally, push the stick forward. The trailing edge should go down. While you're still looking back there, push the left rudder pedal. The trailing edge of the rudder will move to your left. Push the right rudder pedal, and you will get the opposite effect on the rudder. Remember, it's extremely important to check the flight controls completely and thoroughly each time you fly. Moving along in the checklist, the speed brake switch is next. Your speed brake switch should be in the in position for all ground operations. Next, check the IP speed brake. Reach over and feel if it is in the solo position. This is a three-position switch, and the solo position is in the center. With the IP switch in this position, you control the speed brake with the switch on your throttle. You will have control over two air vents. Just twist them to control the amount of airflow. Normally, direct the vents at yourself for maximum comfort. The next few items of your checklist take you across the instrument panel from left to right. Check the landing and taxi light switch off. The IFF antenna should be in the auto position. Ensure the ARU 44 attitude indicator is caged and locked. Then come down to the vertical velocity indicator. Check that the VVI reads zero. If it doesn't, gently tap the instrument to be sure it's not stuck. Set and wind the clock. Next, your checklist directs you to give a firm push on the fuel shutoff T-handles to ensure that they are not pulled out. When they are in the out position, they are only out about half an inch, so it might be difficult to detect visually. The fuel system switch can be placed in the emergency position by pulling the red guard away from the toggle switch and pushing down on the switch. Next, check that the defrost knob is all the way in if you won't be needing it. To reset the accelerometer, just push this little button in the lower left corner and it will return your accelerometer needles to 1G. Now check that the IFF, UHF, VOR, and DME are all off. There are three things you need to do with your air conditioner at this point. Pull the air lever out to the vent position. Place the air temperature control switch to automatic. And finally set the temperature control rheostat to satisfy your comfort. Next, you're to check the circuit breakers. From your position, there are several circuit breakers hidden by the airspeed and turn and slip indicators. You need to reach over and feel that these circuit breakers are in. The ARU 42A attitude indicator should be caged and locked. Fuel boost pump switch, off. Inverter switch, off. Generator switches, on, and they should be guarded on. Pitot heat switch, off. Failure to accomplish this step can result in severe burns to the crew chief. As technique, lift up and pull back on your IP's throttles to ensure they are in the cutoff position. Now you're ready to complete your price check. Hook up your mask and perform a pressure check on the oxygen regulator. First, you should select 100% oxygen and the emergency position. Take a deep breath and hold it. Then determine if there are any leaks in the mask or oxygen system. If your mask doesn't fit properly or is not tight enough, you'll feel oxygen escaping from around the edges. The blinker on the oxygen regulator will indicate if there is a flow. If you are holding your breath, it should not indicate any flow at all. Now return the lever to the normal setting and exhale to check the exhalation valve in your mask. Finally, with the diluter lever still in the 100% position, take a few short breaths and check the blinker for normal operation. Return the diluter lever to the normal position. Remember, the oxygen system check is a challenge and response item. Set up the interphone panel. Normally, the rotary switch is in the COM inter position with all toggle switches outboard. Now, you're ready to apply electrical power to the aircraft. Normally, your battery will provide sufficient power and should be placed on at this point if the APU is not used. If visible moisture or icing conditions are anticipated, the pitot heat will be checked in coordination with the crew chief. This is accomplished by turning the pitot heat switch to the on position while the crew chief checks the heating system. They'll check the pitot tube and the transducer vane on the left wing. When you receive a confirmation that the system checks okay, check the switch to the off position. The next item of your checklist directs you to check the inverter. Check that the main and spare inverters are working by first turning on the spare inverter and then the main. You can hear the spare inverter when it comes on, however, you won't be able to hear the main inverter. As a technique, look for movement in the fuel quantity gauge to confirm AC power is available. It may take 5 to 10 seconds before the gauge begins to move. In the daytime, you normally don't use your interior lights, so turn them off. This is the radio light's rheostat. These two rheostats, located on the center console, control the lighting for your primary instruments. The last rheostat is located on the rear portion of the center console and controls the intensity of lights located underneath the glare shield. Two lights that are often overlooked are the map lights. Be sure that yours is off and ask your instructor to check his off also. Your emergency canopy control switch is found here on the console and should be safety wired closed. The next checklist item concerns the exterior lights. Prior to starting the engines, the navigation light switch must be set to position light only, as required by Air Force Regulation 6016. The anti-collision beacon switch should be off. Continuing on, make sure that both landing gear levers are down by pushing the handles down. Never pull up on the handles while the aircraft is on the ground. Push the landing gear warning light test switch and check that the red warning light comes on in both gear handles. With the warning light switch depressed, place each throttle in idle, one at a time. The gear warning horn should sound. Some IPs also like to check each throttle past the 70% region to ensure the warning horn goes out. The landing gear position indicator lights are shown here. They should be on to indicate that all three gear are down and locked. The fuel boost pump warning light should be on since the boost pump switch is off. The elevator trim is set for takeoff when the green light is on. Check trim operation by actuating the trim button. Click the trim out of the green and then back in again. Now look at your left aileron to see if the aileron trim tab is in the neutral position. You also need to check its operation. This crew chief is pointing out where the trim tab is located on the aileron. Even though the canopy is up at this point, the canopy not locked warning light will be off, because the canopy down lock handle is in the forward position. Make sure the canopy rails are clear, and then move the down lock handle aft to the unlocked position. Check that the warning light illuminates. Motor the canopy down briefly with the internal canopy control switch to ensure proper operation of the canopy motor. Press the engine ice warning light to test the bulb. This button on the left side of the T-handles is the fire detect test circuit. Press it and a steady red light should come on in both of the fuel shutoff T-handles. This button on the right side of the T-handles is the engine overheat test circuit. When you press it, the red lights blink on and off in each T-handle. The fuel low level warning light is next. Press to test it as you did the others. Next, check to see if the fuel light is on. It should be because you're in the fuel system emergency position. Drop down to the fuel quantity gauge to check the fuel quantity. Note that the fuel gauge has a three-position toggle switch. The center position, shown here, allows total fuel to be read from the gauge. Total fuel in the aircraft is 2,008.5 pounds. However, the fuel gauge will normally indicate only about 1,800 pounds of fuel. Now manually position the switch either right or left and release it. This is in preparation for a later step. Just above the RMI is the heading system slaving switch. It has three positions, out, in, and fast. Check that it is in the in position. Your primary attitude indicator is the ARU-44A. Uncage the attitude indicator by pulling out and rotating the caging knob counterclockwise, and then releasing it gently. Adjust the miniature aircraft to coincide with the horizon bar. Your standby attitude indicator is the ARU-42A. It should be uncaged and adjusted in the same manner as the ARU-44A. Note that the indicator should be energized for approximately 60 seconds prior to uncaging. You're now ready to check the wing fuel balance. Earlier, we had moved this switch to either the left or right. That allowed the fuel quantity needle to wind down and register the level of fuel in the wing tank selected. Now check the other side. If there is a fuel imbalance between the wing tanks of more than 160 pounds, don't take the aircraft. Always reposition the toggle switch to the center position after a fuel quantity check. The final item of your interior check concerns stowing all loose items. Check that there is nothing that could fly out of the cockpit and into the intakes during start. You're now ready to start the engines.
This program will review the T-37 engine start procedures. Prior to starting the engines, you need to check for several things. Check for the crew chief and signal him for starting. Ensure a fire bottle is immediately available. Clear the engine intake prior to engaging the starter switch and ensure that refueling operations are not being conducted within 50 feet. Place the fuel boost pump switch to the on position. If the light does not go off, abort the aircraft and note the discrepancy on the Form 781. First, let's start the left engine. Place the starter switch in the ground or up position. Do not hold the switch in the ground position for longer than 20 seconds without signs of EGT rise. If your first attempt to start is unsuccessful, wait 1 minute before repeating the procedure to allow accumulated fuel to drain from the engine. Check with ground personnel to confirm there is no accumulated fuel. If the engine will not start after 3 attempts, wait 10 minutes before initiating any further starts. However, if everything is normal, next place the ignition switch in the on position at 5% RPM. Move the left throttle forward past the cutoff detent to idle at 8% RPM. Use your instructor's throttle for starting so that the cutoff feature is available if shutdown is necessary. If a battery start is attempted and normal starting RPM cannot be obtained, shut down the engine and either have the battery charged, obtain a spare battery, or abort the aircraft. Monitor the EGT gauge for temperature rise. Release the ignition switch at approximately 200 degrees and it will return to the off position. Release the left starter switch when you see the RPM passing 25%. If your finger slips off the starter switch during the start, make no attempt to re-engage the switch. If ignition has occurred and you have released the starter switch prior to 25% RPM, be alert for a hotter than normal start. During start, you must monitor both the EGT and RPM gauges. Additionally, you must be alert for other indications of abnormalities, like fire lights, smoke, or crew chief signals. However, if during the start the EGT rapidly approaches 780 degrees, shut down the engine, obtain an auxiliary power unit, and attempt a second start. If EGT exceeds 780, shut down the engines, abort the aircraft, and write up the excessive temperature in the form 781. The EGT normally peaks as RPM reaches 36 to 38%. The rates of RPM and EGT increase can be compared to see if a hot start will occur. After the EGT peaks, check engine instruments for the following indications. RPM should be in the 36 to 38% range. EGT should be in the 280 to 650 range. Fuel flow should be steady. Oil pressure steady within the 3 to 45 PSI range. Hydraulic pressure should be 1250 to 1550 PSI. If an APU was connected, give the visual disconnect signal to the crew chief. The visual signal is to grasp the index and middle fingers of one hand with the other hand, then withdraw the index and middle fingers quickly from the grasp. Move the battery switch to the on position and note the jump on the left load meter if an APU was used during the start. The load meter should indicate a positive reading. If no positive reading exists, increase the RPM to a maximum of 60%. Remember, generator cut-in speed is 38 to 42%. If by 60% RPM the load meter does not indicate a positive reading, shut down the engine and write up the discrepancy in the form 781. Move the left throttle to 60% and monitor for appropriate reading. The procedures for starting the right engine are the same as those for the left engine. After releasing the right engine starter switch at 25%, retard the left throttle to the idle position. The right engine instrument indications are the same as those specified for the left engine instruments immediately after start. Again, the load meter should indicate a positive reading. If no positive reading exists, use the same procedures discussed earlier. This concludes T-37 engine start procedures.
Once you are satisfied that your engines are operating properly, you're ready to continue with the before taxiing portion of your checklist. Open your checklist to the before taxiing check. First, return the fuel system switch to the normal position. Notice that the switch is covered in this position by the red switch guard. Now place the IFF control switch to standby. Remember, the knob must be pulled out before it can be turned to standby. Turn the UHF radio on by placing the control switch to both. To turn on the VOR ILS, turn the volume control knob to the right. Place the DME selector switch to standby. Push in the cockpit air lever to air condition. Next, check the operation of the speed brake and thrust attenuators. First, give the speed brake signal to the crew chief. The crew chief will clear the area around your speed brake and return the signal. Now place the speed brake switch to the out position. The crew chief will verify that the speed brake and both thrust attenuators have extended. Then return the switch to the in position. In the cockpit, you can monitor the hydraulic pressure drop as the speed brake extends and retracts. Be sure the pressure returns to the normal operating range at the completion of both the extension and retraction cycles. The crew chief will give the OK signal if speed brake and thrust attenuator operations were normal. The flap and spoiler operation check begins when you give the crew chief this signal. As with the speed brake, the crew chief will return the signal when he is ready for you to lower the flaps. Place the flap lever in the full down position. The crew chief will ensure both flaps and spoilers extend. Now return the flaps full up. Once again, the crew chief will make sure the flaps and the spoilers retract normally. Finally, place the flap lever to the 50% detent. Check the flap position indicator to verify the flaps are down 50%. It's also a good idea to visually check that you have a flap down, spoiler up, and confirm this with your IP. The crew chief will give this signal when he is sure the flaps and spoilers are working properly. Now it's time to check the operation of the UHF radio. First, dial in the ground control frequency. Then call for taxi instructions, using the procedures at your base. A response to your call by ground control indicates that your radio is working properly. Next comes the VOR-ILS check. To use the self-test feature, first tune and identify a valid ILS or localizer frequency. The RMI bearing pointer should park at the 4 o'clock position with no off flags or to-from indication in the CI. Also, check for proper CDI deflection in relation to aircraft position. Pressing the VOR-ILS test button will illuminate the marker beacon light. Now, tune and identify a valid VOR frequency. Set 315 in the course select window and press the VOR-ILS test button and hold. If the system is working properly, several things should occur here. The CDI should center plus or minus 2 degrees. The marker beacon light will illuminate. There should be a to indication in the to from window. And the RMI bearing pointer should indicate 315 degrees. This completes the self-test of the VOR-ILS system. If any part of these self-test features does not work properly, pilot discretion and command operating restrictions will be used to determine if the mission can be continued. The DME self-test feature is used to check DME operation. Place the DME mode switch to the test position. While holding the switch, the DME indicator should rotate to 196. Then the red flag should disappear. The self-test is complete. Release the mode switch, and it will automatically return to the DME position. Check the flight instruments next. Remember, check the instruments on the right side of the instrument panel also. You may need them as a backup. When you called for taxi instructions, the ground controller gave you the current altimeter setting. Dial this number in the window on your altimeter. The indicated altitude should be plus or minus 75 feet of ramp elevation. The airspeed indicator should be between 30 and 40 knots indicated airspeed. Now, compare the heading on the J2 compass with the magnetic compass. They should agree within plus or minus 5 degrees. Here, the J2 compass is indicating 230 degrees, and the mag compass is indicating 228 degrees. Also, make sure the magnetic compass is full of fluid and there are no cracks or bubbles. The last of the flight instruments is the attitude indicator. Ensure both attitude indicators are set for level flight with no off flag showing. The checklist now directs you to remove, display, and stow the ejection seat and canopy safety pins. To remove the seat pin, first place your left hand palm down on top of the left hand grip to hold it down. Then reach down with your right hand and remove the pin. Hold the left hand grip down until the red streamer has cleared the seat. Now, reach over and carefully remove the canopy safety pin and then display both pins to the crew chief. Stow your pins and challenge your IP to show and stow his pin also. Now check the brakes for sufficient pedal pressure by smoothly applying pressure to the top of the pedal. Challenge your IP to do the same and make sure you get the proper response. Position your taxi light as required, normally to the taxi position. Check the anti-collision beacon as required, generally off. Give the crew chief this signal to remove the chocks, and you're ready to taxi. This completes the before taxi check. Now we'll be covering in-flight checks.
My oxygen's on normal, normal. Good blinker, 400. How about you?
Mine's on normal, normal. Good blinker, 400 also.
Each stage of your flight, from your arrival at the aircraft to mission completion, requires some type of check. This program discusses the checks you'll perform during the airborne portion of your flight. During most of your in-flight checks, you'll use the checklist just like you did on the ground. You may either preview the checklist before the check, reference the checklist item by item, or review the checklist after the check. The important thing to remember is, use the checklist to ensure that all the items are accomplished. There are some checks, however, that must be performed during critical phases of flight. That is, during the takeoff, landing, and go-around phases. During these checks, you may not have time to refer to the checklist, so you'll have to commit these checks to memory. Let's look at the in-flight checks in the order you'll normally do them, starting with the after takeoff check. Once you're airborne, you'll need to raise the gear at 100 knots minimum. Before you raise the handle, make sure you're climbing and call gear clear to your IP. While you're in the pre-solo portion of your training, your IP must acknowledge this call before you raise the gear handle. Simply raising the gear handle does not complete this step, though. You must continue to monitor the gear handle to ensure the red light goes out prior to 150 knots. However, you may continue with the next step while the gear are retracting. Make sure the landing lights are set to either the taxi or off position. You'll normally fly with the switch in the taxi position. Since you don't change the position of this switch on most takeoffs, it's easy to get in the habit of not checking it at all. Watch out. This has caused many students to try and overspeed the landing lights after a touch and go from a straight-in approach. At 110 knots minimum, you should raise the flaps. To be sure the flaps have fully retracted, check the flap indicator. Although the indicator only shows the position of the right flap, you can be sure both flaps are retracting if the aircraft has no unusual rolling tendencies. Now you should check the engine instruments for normal indications. Your IP may suggest that you also check these instruments before you raise the gear. This will allow you more time to make an abort decision should you have any engine malfunction. On your climb out, the next check you'll normally do is the climb check. As you pass 10,000 feet MSL, disconnect and stow your zero delay lanyard. You can hook it to the small wire ring next to the D handle as shown here. This is a challenge and response item, so you'll need to check with your IP to make sure he disconnects his lanyard also. Now check your oxygen. The airborne price check is just like the one you did in the chocks, except that the white diluter lever stays in normal. As you reach for the emergency lever, make sure your hand goes in front of the throttles. Otherwise, your glove or sleeve could get caught on the canopy jettison T-handle. Now check the fuel quantity. 1,700 pounds is normal for the early portion of a flight. Throughout your flight, you'll need to make an additional check that is not in your checklist, and that's a check to ensure your wing tanks are feeding the fuselage tank. Your first balance check is done at 1,600 to 1,700 pounds, and then about every 15 minutes during the flight. An imbalance of 160 pounds is the max you can accept with no malfunction in the system. When the toggle switch is centered, the gauge shows the total fuel on board. To check the fuel in the wings, you need to flip the switch to the right and read the quantity. Then do the same for the left wing. A word of caution here. Always place the toggle switch back to the center or total position. If you don't, you may misinterpret your actual fuel quantity later in the flight. In addition to checking the fuel balance, you should also check that the total fuel on board is correct. Let's assume we have 550 pounds in each wing tank, adding up to 1,100 pounds total. We can assume the fuselage tank is a little less than completely full, so just round 565.5 down to 550 and add that to the wing total. Your total on the gauge should read close to 1,650 pounds. If the total fuel is significantly less than 1,650 pounds, fuel is not flowing from the wings. Switch the fuel system to emergency and refer to your checklist emergency procedures. Here, the total on the fuel gauge is correct, so we can continue the flight. As you're doing your in-flight checks, remember you must continue to clear for other aircraft, birds, and other hazards. The common problem you need to avoid is burying your head in the cockpit while doing a check. You've got to clear throughout each step of the checklist with only short glances inside. Once you level off at your cruising or maneuvering altitude, get the jet trimmed up and start your level off check. This check is similar to the climb check. In fact, the oxygen check is identical. After checking your system, make sure you challenge your IP to do the same. Now check your load meters. If you've been flying for at least 10 minutes, both load meters should indicate 0.5 or below. Like the fuel system, the load meter should also be checked at least every 15 minutes during the flight. Should the load meters indicate more than 0.5, you'll have to refer to the emergency checklist pages. A fuel balance check is also required on the level off check. Look at this series of slides as we make a fuel balance check. The gauge indicates a total of about 1,550 pounds. Here's the left wing. Now the right wing. Are the wing totals within the balance limits? Well, let's go through it. There's about 475 pounds in the left wing and about 550 pounds in the right wing. Since the difference is less than 160 pounds, our check is within the limits. Now, from what we just looked at, can you determine if the wing tanks are feeding normally? Again, they are. 475 plus 550 from the wing tanks and approximately 550 from the fuselage tank should mean a total of about 1575. Since the total gauge indication was 1550, you can assume the wing tanks are feeding normally. Here's a helpful technique. If you're leveling off at or below 14,000 feet, you may combine the climb and level off checks. The most common technique used to do this is to disconnect and stow your zero delay passing 10,000 feet MSL. Then finish the remaining climb check steps with your level off check when you reach your cruising altitude. The next check you'll do is the before descent check. Normally, the descent portion of your flight is very busy, so you'll want to make sure you accomplish this check before you start down from your cruising altitude or leave your area. First, check your heading and attitude systems. Cross-check the RMI and the J2, here reading about 220, against the magnetic compass. They should agree within plus or minus 5 degrees. If they don't, you need to actuate the fast slave cycle. During the fast slave cycle, you need to maintain a constant airspeed and constant heading for 3 minutes. So make sure you've got plenty of area in front of you before actuating it. Check your attitude indicators to ensure both instruments indicate the proper flight attitude. If they don't, cage and adjust them. Now check the pitot heat, defrost, and cockpit temperature set as required. The pitot heat should be on if your descent will be through visible moisture. Use the defrost to preheat the windscreen if you've been cruising at high altitudes for an extended period of time or will be making a rapid descent to keep the canopy from fogging up. Finally, the cockpit temperature should be set for your comfort. Now, you need to do another fuel quantity and balance check. This check should have been a recurring one throughout your flight. Although your zero delay must always be connected prior to 10,000 feet, you'll normally connect it during the before descent check. Challenge your IP on this step until you get the proper response from him. The current altimeter setting can be obtained from the controlling agency you are working with. Before initiating your descent, ensure your altimeter has the current setting and challenge your IP to confirm the right cockpit altimeter is also set. Helmet visors as required depends upon the time of day and flight conditions. During daylight, with good visibility, you'll normally wear both visors down if you have a dual visor helmet. When lighting or visibility is restricted, you should raise the dark visor. If you have a single visor helmet, you'll normally use the dark visor during daytime operations. At night, you should use your clear visor. Remember, your visors offer significant protection for your eyes if you have a bird strike. As you're descending, plan your arrival and accomplish the approach to field check. On your contact sorties, you'll normally complete this check prior to entering the traffic pattern. Make sure your zero delay is connected. A successful low-altitude ejection may depend on it. Be sure to challenge your instructor until you get a response out of him. Check your hydraulic pressure. You should have between 1250 and 1550 PSI. A fuel quantity check is also required during this portion of your flight. You want to make sure you have sufficient fuel for completing the number and type of patterns you desire. The next check you'll normally do is to keep you from landing with the wrong configuration. Always perform a before landing check to confirm you've configured the aircraft correctly. Remember, since this check is normally done during critical phase of flight, you'll have to commit it to memory. Make sure your speed brake switch is set as required for the type of landing you're doing. Now confirm the gear are down and locked. You should have three green, no red light in the gear handle, and no gear warning horn. It's also a good idea to check your hydraulic pressure for a normal indication. This is one check you can't afford to forget. Now confirm the flap setting required for the type of landing you're doing. The correct indication here on the gauge, with no unusual rolling tendencies of the aircraft, should confirm your flap setting. Check your landing light position. Get in the habit now of checking this item on every before landing check, whether you use the landing light or not. The last in-flight check is also one you'll have to commit to memory. You'll perform this check when you make the decision to go around or execute a missed approach. As soon as you make your decision, advance the throttles to military and ensure the speed brake switch is in. If the go-around decision was made very near the runway, touchdown may be unavoidable. Do not try to hold the aircraft off the runway. If you do happen to touch down, lower the nose slightly to help accelerate back to takeoff airspeed. Then establish the takeoff attitude and allow the aircraft to fly off the runway. When you're sure that you'll remain airborne and you have a minimum of 100 knots, raise the gear. Don't forget to check your landing lights at this point also. At 110 knots minimum, raise the flaps. Continue monitoring gear and flap retraction for normal indications. Now, do a quick check of your engine instruments for normal indications. Throughout your Air Force career, no matter what you fly, you'll be using in-flight checks. Checks that will help you safely accomplish the mission. Take the time now to develop proper checklist discipline.
Post-flight checks are last of the many checklist procedures you'll perform on each flight. The checks normally begin as you are off the runway onto the taxiway. After clearing the runway, comply with local directives to accomplish the after-landing check. Open your checklist to this check and follow along. To keep this from happening when you open the canopy, be sure that all loose items, such as navigation maps, pencils, checklist, in-flight guides, and so forth, are stored. Prior to opening the canopy, challenge your IP to ensure his loose items are also secured. Install the canopy jettison T-handle safety pin. Take care to install the pin correctly. Is this pin installed correctly? Yes, the straight portion of the pin is in the hole just forward of the T-handle and will properly safety the jettison system. Install your seat pin and ask the other pilot to install his pin also. Do not move the hand grips to insert the pin. This could result in inadvertently arming the ejection system. Check to ensure that the speed brake switch is in the in position. If you retracted the speed brake during the landing roll, this would be a double check to ensure that it's up. Since you no longer need it, the IFF should be turned off at this time. The VOR, ILS, and DME switches should also be placed in the off position. The pitot heat switch should be turned off so that the pitot tube will cool off by the time you reach the parking area. Set landing lights according to local directives, generally to either taxi or off. Set anti-collision beacons as required. Generally, place the switch to the off position. Next, set the navigation lights to position lights only. Place the flap handle to the up position as directed in the next checklist item. To ensure the flaps are retracting, check the flap indicator. As you taxi back to the chocks, you may want to check with your IP and shut down the rampside engine. Prior to shutting down the engine, move the fuel system switch to emergency. This rampside engine shutdown procedure is often used for noise abatement. It also helps slow down your taxi speed and reduce wear on the brakes. If an engine is shut down, check the hydraulic pressure. If you lose hydraulic pressure, stop the aircraft, shut down the other engine, and call for a tug and pins. If your hydraulic pressure is good, continue to the parking area. After you've stopped the aircraft, continue holding the brakes until the wheel chocks are installed. Now proceed with your checks. First, check that the EGT is stable and note any signs of engine roughness. Then place the fuel system switch to the emergency position, if it's not already there. Use the IP's throttles to shut down the engines. Lift up on his throttles and pull them back to the cutoff position. The engine ice warning light should illuminate after placing the left throttle to cutoff and before the left RPM reaches zero. If the light does not illuminate, write it up in the form 781. Install the seat and canopy jettison T-handle safety pins, if not previously installed. Don't forget to challenge your IP on this item. Move the canopy down lock handle forward to the locked position. Turn off the UHF radio. Turn off all interior and exterior lights. Normally, the navigation lights and the taxi light will be the only exterior lights that need to be turned off at this point. If you've used any interior lights, now is the time to turn them off. Cage and lock both attitude indicators. You'll normally need to click the trim forward to return it to the neutral position. Turn the boost pump off. The inverter switch should also be placed in the off position. Now, turn the battery off. Check the oxygen regulator. You should place the diluter lever in the 100% position to prevent the system from becoming contaminated while the aircraft is on the ground. Be sure to challenge your IP to ensure that his oxygen diluter lever is in the 100% position. Ensure the rudder pedals are neutral, then place a control lock into position to lock the flight controls. Check that the crew chief has placed the wheel chocks around the main gear. Before you leave the aircraft, make sure your goal key is secured on your parachute harness. Inadvertent deployment of your parachute would surely ruin your day. There are just a few more things you should check before walking off. Check that the gear safety pins have been installed and that the pitot tube is properly covered. Now you're ready to do some paperwork. Your workbook explains how to properly fill out the 781, so it will not be covered in this program.
Explains the procedures to follow in executing a formation wing takeoff. When the flight is cleared for takeoff, the lead aircraft will taxi onto the side of the runway as briefed, in this case, the left side, and will allow the wingman room to maneuver into position. As wingman, roll forward into the takeoff position with approximately 10 feet lateral wingtip clearance and stop on an extension of the fingertip position. As a reference for the 30-degree fingertip line, check that the pilot's helmet is aligned with the outside flap hinge. Also, note how it looks to be level with the lead aircraft. You should maintain this position throughout the takeoff until gear and flaps are retracted. When the leader gives the run-up signal, acknowledge with a head nod and perform your lineup check according to the checklist. Pump up the brakes to ensure you don't roll forward as power is applied. Do your checklist items one at a time and continue to cross-check lead. When you've completed your checks, nod to lead indicating you're ready. Release brakes on the leader's signal and adjust power as required to hold your position on the takeoff roll. Use nose wheel steering for directional control. Your primary attention should be on lead. However, use peripheral vision to detect any lateral movement on the runway. As lead rotates to the takeoff attitude, match his pitch. Stack level by keeping leader's helmet on the horizon as you leave the ground. Anticipate leader's gear retraction, and when you see the leader's gear begin to move, raise your gear. Continue stacking level. When the leader raises his flaps, raise yours. And move into the normal fingertip position. Throughout the takeoff, maintain position by making smooth, positive control applications. Avoid making large power changes, and above all, discipline yourself to trust your leader to get the formation safely airborne. Don't be satisfied with less than a perfect wing position. Two's responsibility is to stay in position. On stalls are flown so that you can recognize and recover from a nose-high attitude full stall. The recovery from the full stall will be initiated when control effectiveness is lost. In other words, when the nose begins to drop or the aircraft begins an unplanned rolling motion. It's important to remember that the recovery may be initiated prior to obtaining full aft stick. Adjust your throttles as required and clear the area. It's important to clear the area you'll be flying into. In this case, it will be above and in front of the aircraft. Raise the nose to a 15 to 50 degree pitch attitude. Raising the nose until the air conditioning vents are on the horizon will give you about 20 degrees of pitch. Raising the nose until the horizon goes through the intersection of the canopy bow and the canopy rail will give you approximately 40 degrees of pitch. Regardless of the pitch attitude, adjust back pressure and attempt to maintain the pitch until control effectiveness is lost. When control effectiveness is lost, recover by using stick forces as necessary to decrease the angle of attack while simultaneously advancing the throttles to military power. Use the rudder as necessary to level the wings until the ailerons become effective. When you regain flying airspeed, apply back pressure to recover with a minimum loss of altitude. Use caution not to enter a secondary stall. The turning stall is accomplished in much the same manner as the straight-ahead stall. Many IPs use the technique of having at least 150 knots prior to starting the second stall. This allows time to set pitch and bank prior to the stall. With the power readjusted, raise the nose while simultaneously banking 20 to 30 degrees in either direction. As airspeed decreases, back pressure will be necessary to maintain pitch. Aileron pressure away from the direction of the turn will also be necessary to maintain the bank angle. When control effectiveness is lost, again recover by using stick forces as necessary to decrease the angle of attack and rudder to eliminate yaw while simultaneously adjusting the throttles to military power. Complete the maneuver by returning to level flight.
I'm flying the normal overhead pattern in the T-37. Now I'm going to cover this in four different parts. First, we'll take a look at what the overhead pattern is, how it's flown, and review some of the terminology used. Then we'll see how that applies to flying the pattern in the T-37, getting down to the actual nuts and bolts of what to do and some techniques on how to do it. Then we'll put you in the cockpit as we take a look at some real-time video footage so you can see how quickly things happen and get an idea of the pacing and the timing of what's going to be going on in the pattern. Then finally, we'll wrap things up by looking at some techniques on how to fly any type of overhead pattern, whether it be a left-hand pattern or a right-hand pattern in the T-37. So let's start by looking at what the overhead pattern is, how it's flown, and reviewing some of the terminology used. Now when we talk about the traffic pattern, we normally see it depicted something like this. We can actually see two patterns here. There's the overhead pattern depicted by the racetrack, and then there's the box pattern, which gets us around and set up to shoot the overhead pattern. Now as we go around the box, remember, we have crosswind, outside downwind, 90 to initial, 45 to initial, and the initial leg, which is the start of our overhead pattern. To look at the overhead, let's break it out of this depiction and put it up on the blackboard here, where we can take a better look at it. We'll start on initial, where you're about 1,000 feet above the ground, coming in aligned with the runway. Fly down over the runway until you reach a breakpoint. The breakpoint, you reduce your power, roll into about 60 degrees of bank, make a nice level turn, and roll out on inside downwind. You're still about 1,000 feet above the ground. You'll continue to slow, and when you get to a safe airspeed, you'll configure the aircraft with gear and flaps. Fly down to the point where you'll begin your final turn. This point's also known as the perch point. You'll come off the perch and make a nice symmetrical descending turn to roll out on final, align with the runway, pick up a normal glide path, and continue in to land. Now that we know what the parts are of the pattern and how it's flown, how do we do it in the T-37? Well, let's get down to the actual nuts and bolts of what to do. As you turn on to initial, plan the rollout so your ground track is aligned with the runway center line. The winds will determine if you have to crab or not. Now on initial, you'll be holding 200 knots. A good power setting to hold 200 knots in the pattern is about 80%. Also, after rolling out, make your radio call. The most important thing you can do on initial and around the pattern is to clear. And clearing means not only using your eyes, but using the radios as well. As you approach the break, visually clear the inside downwind for other aircraft. Pay attention to radio calls too, since they aid in locating conflicts. As you approach the runway, you're going to have to pick your break point. But to do this, You first need to know where the brake zone is. 51.4 states that the brake zone extends from the approach end of the runway down to 3,000 feet down the runway, and you can brake anywhere in this zone. Exactly where you do brake will depend on a number of factors, including winds, different traffic situations, and your proficiency. Now, to accomplish the brake, you'll need to reduce your power and make a level 60-degree bank turn. Trimming is important, as the stick forces are going to change rapidly because the airspeed's changing rapidly. Keep your head up and look outside as you make the turn, cross-checking inside only momentarily. When you've completed the turn, roll out on inside downwind and lower the speed brake. Let's look at what these mean. When you reduce your power, how far do you need to bring it back? 51.4 says reduce it as required to slow the jet to between 120 and 150 knots. As technique, bringing the throttles back to 50 to 60% works well. Once you reduce your power, smoothly roll into a bank of about 60 degrees and make a level steep turn by looking outside and dragging your bug spot across the horizon. If you're correcting for winds, you may vary the bank and back pressure to adjust your spacing on inside downwind. Because of the rapid change in airspeed in the brake, trim is very important. One technique commonly used to help you in trimming is to use one short click of trim for every beep of the gear warning horn. Keeping your head up and looking outside is important not only in the brake, but in the rest of the pattern as well. Your primary reference should be the horizon, with short glances back inside the cockpit. Don't let yourself fixate on the instruments while you're in the brake. Finally, after rolling out parallel to the runway on inside downwind, you'll lower the speed brake. Keep in mind, however, that winds or spacing may require you to extend the speed brake while still on the brake. As we roll out on inside downwind, we have to keep in mind what we're trying to accomplish here, and that is to get to the perch on altitude, on airspeed, with the proper displacement. And if we can do those three things, we've got the pattern wired. So let's look at the steps we're going to accomplish on inside downwind. After rolling out on inside downwind, check your displacement from the runway and make any adjustments that are necessary. You'll continue to slow down, and when you get below 150 knots, lower the gear. Once the gear comes down, you'll need to bring the power back up to about 80% to catch 120 knots, which is your minimum airspeed on downwind. While all this is going on and your airspeed is changing, you'll still need to trim off the forward stick pressures. Finally, before you roll off the perch, lower your flaps to full. Now let's go back through these one at a time. For proper spacing, place the runway between the fuel filler cap and the double row of rivets. The whole point is to plan downwind displacement so as to need only 30 degrees of bank in the final turn. While you're checking your spacing, the aircraft will continue to slow down. When your airspeed decreases to 150 knots or below, firmly grasp the gear handle and lower the gear. With the gear coming down, speed brake out, and power back, we're rapidly slowing down, and we need to bring the power up to about 80% to catch 120 knots. As technique, if you put the gear handle down and then bring the power right up, you'll have no problem catching 120 knots. The whole time we're slowing and putting the gear down, we don't want to lose any altitude. So in combination with trimming, we also need to raise the nose slightly. To give you an idea of the pitch change necessary, take a look at the difference between the level flight pitch picture for 200 knots, as shown here, and the level flight pitch picture at 120 knots with gear and speed breakdown, as shown here. Once you reach this point, your airspeed should finally stabilize. So take the time to trim off all stick pressures and watch how easy it becomes to hold pattern altitude. Again, remember what our goal is: to get to the perch on altitude, on airspeed, with proper displacement. finally, after checking your gear down, lower the flaps to full. Check the gauge to ensure the flaps are lowering, and also check for any rolling tendencies which might indicate an unsymmetrical flap condition. Now that we know what to do on inside downwind, we're ready to start the final turn, right? Well, not quite. First, we need to know how to find the perch so that we know where to start the final turn. Well, that's no problem. Since the final turn is symmetrical, for a no-wind condition, we'll start it when we're abeam the rollout point. Now, the rollout point for a normal pattern is between a half and three quarters of a mile from the approach end of the runway. When you're abeam that point, you're at the perch, and that's where you'll be starting your final turn. Now, as you can tell, you're going to have to pick your rollout point sometime before you reach the perch. As technique, once you get the jet configured, trimmed up, and with good spacing, look for that half to three-quarter mile reference from the runway and mark it with the closest landmark, either a tree, a pond, a house, a road, whatever is close. Then before you get abeam that point, you can roll your flaps down, check the gauge, and check for any rolling tendencies. Meanwhile, you'll have gotten abeam your rollout point, and you can start the final turn. Now, anytime you have winds, it will change all this slightly, but it's important that you understand the basics. Remember, we're trying to make the final turn a nice, symmetrical descending turn to roll out on final aligned with the runway. To start the final turn, there are several things we need to do. First, you'll need to clear final. Then reduce your power to about 70%. Start your turn using about 30 degrees of bank, and then lower your nose until you see about two-thirds ground and one-third sky out the windscreen. Clearing final means checking for aircraft in front of you or on a straight end to ensure that it's safe to continue to land. The last three steps are usually done simultaneously, but initially you'll find it easier to do them one at a time. Reduce your power just slightly below 70%. 70% should ring a bell, because that's when the thrust attenuators will come out and help us control our airspeed. Start the turn using about 30 degrees of bank, and then lower the nose till you see about two-thirds ground and one-third sky out the windscreen. A point to bring up here. Don't stare at the runway as you start the final turn. Set this picture, 30 degrees of bank and two-thirds ground, one-third sky, by looking straight ahead and using the horizon. You'll have plenty of time to reference the runway after you set a good picture. Another method you can use to start the final turn is to lower your nose to the proper pitch first and then roll into bank. Now, it doesn't matter which method you use as long as you're consistent. Use the same method each time so that you can start building a habit pattern. That's what's important. As you continue the final turn, slow to 110 knots and trim off the stick pressures. Accomplish the before landing check and then make your gear down call. During the turn, cross-check your airspeed, the rollout point, and the runway, and try to project your flight path around the final turn, over the rollout point, and down final. In slowing to and maintaining your final turn airspeed of 110 knots, you'll be taking advantage of the thrust attenuators. Since they'll be extended when the power is below 70% and retracted when above 70%, you'll be able to control your airspeed by making small power corrections or being in and out of the thrust attenuators. Since we've changed our airspeed from 120 to 110 knots in the final turn, we need to retrim the aircraft. Now, we're not trimming to the horn here like we were before. Instead, you'll need just a few clicks of trim to relieve any stick pressures that you feel. Once you've slowed and trimmed up the aircraft, accomplish the before landing check. Speed brake down, gear down, flaps full, and landing lights to taxi. It's also a good idea to check the hydraulic pressure, even though it's not required by the checklist. Since this check happens during a critical phase of flight, your IP may give you some techniques on how to remember these items without referencing the checklist. As soon as safely possible, after you complete the check, make your gear down call. Now, don't sacrifice your aircraft control to either do the check or make the radio call. Remember, your first priority is to fly the jet. In the final turn, you'll need to continuously cross-check inside and outside references. Divide your attention between the airspeed indicator, the rollout point, and the runway. Airspeed, rollout point, runway. Finally, the thing that can probably help you the most during the turn is to visualize and project your descent angle around the final turn, over the rollout point, and down the final approach. If you can do this, you'll start to develop a good picture of what the final turn and final should look like, which will help you to recognize the need to make any corrections. After rolling out on final and aligned with the runway, you've got two objectives: to maintain runway alignment and to maintain a smooth, constant glide path to round out and touchdown. To accomplish these objectives, we can break the final approach down into several steps. First, to help maintain a constant glide path, set a good aim point and put it about halfway up the windscreen. You'll also need to slow to a final approach airspeed of 100 knots and trim off the pressures. Recheck your runway alignment and plan to maintain a minimum of 50% RPM on final. When rolling out on final, a slight pitch increase will be required to break your descent from the final turn and pick up the proper glide path. A good final approach pitch reference is to put the beginning or threshold of the runway about halfway up the windscreen. Again, we'll be using the thrust attenuators to help us slow to our final approach airspeed of 100 knots. Remember to keep the airspeed in your cross-check as you fly down final. Once your airspeed is stabilized, trim off any stick pressures. Recheck your alignment with the runway to ensure you're on the desired ground track. This will be an ongoing process along with checking your aim point and airspeed. Finally, because of the slow windup of the T-37 engines, plan to maintain a minimum of 50% RPM on each engine while on final. Continue down final, maintaining runway alignment and a smooth, constant glide path. Continue to check your aim point and airspeed. Also, get in the habit of rechecking your gear and flaps on final for every landing. As you approach the threshold of the runway, you'll reach a point where landing is assured, or the point where you can start decreasing your power to idle. As you get closer to the runway, start your round out by smoothly applying back pressure on the stick to decrease your rate of descent. Once you touch down, apply the procedures for either a touch and go or full stop landing. Now up to this point, we've been looking at the pattern piece by piece. But now we're going to put it all together and look at it real time so that you can get an idea of the timing and the pacing of how quickly things are going to happen. The video you're about to watch will set you up as you roll out on initial for runway 32 left here at Randolph. And we'll be doing the normal overhead pattern with a left break. After rolling out on initial, make your radio call.
Tiger 1-4, initial.
About 80% power will hold your 200 knots. Clear, both visually and on the radios. Check the winds and plan your pattern accordingly. Find the brake zone and pick your brake point. Before starting the brake, clear inside downwind. Reduce your power and roll into about 60 degrees of bank. Trim with the horn. Keep your head up and looking outside. Drag your bug spot across the horizon to keep the turn level. As you roll out parallel to the runway, lower the speed brake. Check your spacing. Continue to trim, and as your airspeed gets below 150 knots, lower the gear. Bring your power back up to about 80% to catch 120 knots. Recheck your spacing and make any necessary corrections. Start looking for the rollout point a half to three quarters a mile from the threshold of the runway. Just before you get a beam your rollout point, check your gear down and then lower your flaps to full. Check for any rolling tendencies. As you get a beam the point, reduce your power to about 70% and set a good picture. About 30 degrees of bank and two-thirds ground, one-third sky. Slow to 110 knots. Do your before landing check and make your radio call.
Tiger 1-4, gear down.
Visualize the glide path extending out from the runway and turn onto it. Roll out on final, aligned with the runway, and slow to 100 knots. Keep your aim point on the threshold and cross-check your airspeed for 100 knots. When landing is assured, powers to idle and start your round out. We've talked extensively on how to do the overhead to the left. But what happens when we go to do an overhead pattern with a right brake? Well, it's good news. Everything stays the same. All the procedures and techniques we've talked about still apply. The only difference is how the runway will look to you on inside downwind. You recall that when you do a left-hand pattern, the runway is on your side and easy to see. But when you do a right-hand pattern, you have to look cross cockpit to see the runway, and it makes it a little tougher. Well, to give you an idea of what it looks like, let's take a look at the picture here on the board. This is what you'll be seeing when you look cross cockpit. Now for normal spacing, the runway will be right here, just below the canopy rail. Now for you to see it, you're going to have to look in the corner of the windscreen right here. As you can tell from the video footage, you're only going to get glimpses of the runway during a right-hand pattern. This is going to necessitate picking a point in front of you on the horizon and flying to it. You can cross-check the runway once or twice by dipping the wing down to get a better look. Watch out though, because if you keep dipping your wing and don't correct back to your original ground track, you're basically turning into the runway and you're going to get closer and closer to it. Now another thing I want to mention here is how to set the power settings without staring at the tachometers. Now you're already learning the approximate power settings in the overhead pattern, so let's look at how to set them by feel. Now the two power settings that are easy to find and that you already know are mill power, which is all the way up against the forward stop, and idle, which is all the way back. To set the power at about 50 to 60%, which can be used in the brake, bring the throttles back to idle and then up a knob width. To set the power at about 80%, which you'll use around the box and also on inside downwind, bring the throttles straight up and down and then back a knob width. By knowing how to set the approximate power setting by feel, it will greatly enhance your ability to keep your head up out of the cockpit and to clear. Finally, to keep you out of trouble, let's cover a few things you don't want to do when flying the overhead pattern. As you come up initial, you need to listen up on the radios. If there's a T-37 on a straight-in approach, and he's between 5 and 2 miles, do not initiate the brake unless the controller directs you to do so. This is because the two of you would become a conflict on final. As you approach the perch, again, you need to be clearing. Do not start the final turn if there is another aircraft in the final turn and not in sight, or if there is a straight-in inside of 2 miles and not in sight, or if you can't maintain normal pattern size and safe spacing. If you don't have the aircraft in front of you in sight, break out from the downwind leg using local procedures. Because of crosswinds, it may be necessary to vary your bank angle in the final turn. You may increase the bank up to 45 degrees. However, you should remember that the stall speed of the aircraft will also increase. If you have any doubt about the safety of continuing the approach, go around. Well, that about wraps up the basics of flying the normal overhead pattern in the T-37. Now, I realize we've gone into a lot of detail here today, so feel free to go back and review this material as many times as you need to until it sinks in. As a matter of fact, the tape also makes an excellent chair flying aid, so take advantage of that too. Good luck, and fly smart.
Coming from the right, the Blue Angels in diamond formation, 3 feet separating them from wingtip to canopy. Summer afternoon, somewhere in the United States, six A-4 Skyhawks streak across the sky, transformed into instruments of aerial artistry, flown by a team of men who have worked months to perfect a performance of precision. They are neither stunt flyers, daredevils, or showmen. They are naval aviators with an extremely difficult mission to perform. Recruiting, that's their main job. Attracting young men to naval careers, both in the air and on the ground. Also, they demonstrate to Navy student flyers the kind of airmanship the Navy expects of them. And they bring the Navy to the American public. This is the story of that mission as they tell it. The U.S. Navy Flight Demonstration Squadron, the Blue Angels.
Meeting the public is our primary job. We try to relate to people every year, to young people, to adults, and to real aerospace enthusiasts that there, in fact, is someone flying in the aircraft.
Those are air refueling probes. You have a big aircraft, like a tanker, that flies in front of you.
Do you like the air show?
Okay.
We'll see you later.
Well, you guys are pretty good, I'll tell you.
Hey, thank you very much.
You are. Did you enjoy it?
Sure did. Here you go, young fella. How's that?
Thank you very much.
There you go.
One of the most enjoyable aspects of getting involved with the communities that we visit across the country is the chance to occasionally visit orphanages, high schools, and hospitals.
How old are they?
One's 16, another's 14, another's 13. One's 11,
no small.
Number
You're the smallest one in the family.
That's a good card.
I think he's going to tear it all apart again.
Yeah, I think so too.
You'll be happy.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
There's a get well card for you, okay?
A big part of our public appearances have to do with our recruiting work, like dinners and face-to-face conversations with college students who are prospects for a naval career.
Took me down to an air show in Sanford, Florida.
United States Navy?
So far, it looks like that.
what's your feelings toward the type aircraft that you want to fly when you get out?
Being able to handle yourself in a social situation demands a talent just like flying does. It's difficult to adapt to all the different categories of crowd, whether they be professionals, students, or even military personnel. To adapt to them and to relate our job is a difficult task.
Next to the leader's aircraft, or in a relative position to his aircraft, that becomes more difficult because of the aerodynamic loads that are on.
Like we said, we have a mission. And the accomplishment of this mission is a difficult task, and we could never do it without a couple of things that have been long-standing traditions with the Blues. Those two things are teamwork and a striving for perfection. And that is the real story to tell about the Blue Angels.
The real story of the Blue Angels. They come from the ranks of naval aviators assigned to the fleet. Every year, applicants are reviewed by the Bureau of Naval Personnel, and a report is made on their past performance, their record as naval officers in all their assignments. A readout on 20 applicants is given to the team, and they assess the ability, qualifications, and motivation of each individual. Then, 3 to 4 aviators are selected to fill the new openings, to become Blue Angels. Pensacola Naval Air Station, the home of the Blue Angels. Every year, 6 pilots embark on a grueling schedule, months of daily practice. Their objective? Perfection.
Okay, I'm set to have a good one out at field number 6, huh? Oh, in case anyone's interested, Chuck and Johnny...
As in any other profession, practice makes perfect. And all the maneuvers that you learn in flight training must be developed to a state of absolute perfection. And your first reaction is, when you join the team, that it can't be done.
Watching an air show, what we do may seem quite impossible. But the reason for that is because no one individual could do it alone. However, as a team, we begin to realize that the final results can be achieved. So we subordinate ourselves, and we only think of one thing, and that's teamwork.
Blue Angels are similar to any other good team with a lot of individual sacrifice and self-discipline. But not only do we learn an individual higher level of concentration, we learn to think together.
One thing you keep in your mind all the time is that no matter what you're doing, you give it your very best effort. You learn to put forth that 110% effort each and every time.
When we say we depend upon each other, we're not talking about just the pilots alone. We're talking about the maintenance personnel as well. The kind of flying that we do, we allow very, very little margin for error for the pilots, and we allow absolutely no margin of error for our maintenance technicians.
We're out there every day just like the pilots. We want to know that plane, every part in it from front to back, and we check it, and then we double check it. When we turn that aircraft over to them, we know it's right. We've got a tradition, an air show has never had to be canceled due to maintenance problems. We're going to make sure we preserve that tradition.
And each year, that tradition is preserved as the Blue Angels bring a perfect blend of men and machines to another air show season. Nearly every weekend morning throughout the summer, these aircraft stand ready, their powerful engines quiet, but ready to spring to life in the afternoon sun. And the Blue Angels are ready. Ready to demonstrate their mastery of low-level formation flying and precision aerial techniques.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is Lieutenant John Patton, narrator of the United States Navy Flight Demonstration Squadron, the Blue Angels. For more than 60 years, the United States Navy has kept abreast of aviation technology by flying the most modern aircraft available, from both land-based installations and aircraft carrier flight decks the world over. Spanning the last 27 years, a select group of naval aviators have had the opportunity to demonstrate the precision techniques of naval aviation to the public, hoping to inspire our young men and women to choose careers in the United States Navy. Now, if I may direct your attention to the ramp before us, I ask that you observe the manner in which the 6 demonstration pilots approach their aircraft, are saluted by their crew chiefs, and receive last-minute instructions on the status of their assigned aircraft. The precision maneuvers you will see demonstrated here this afternoon are coordinated tactical techniques developed in training and in actual combat by our Navy and Marine Corps pilots. In combat, these maneuvers might be flown from treetop level to 60,000 feet. But for the team, it is a continuous demonstration of their skill and training in a very low altitude environment. The aircraft you will see being flown here this afternoon is the McDonnell Douglas A4F Skyhawk, a single-seat, light attack aircraft, versions of which have been operational with the United States Navy and Marine Corps since 1955.
Training pay off when we can go up in the air and show what it's possible to achieve through teamwork and dedicated effort. I guess what we're ultimately trying to show is that high goals and high ideals are well worth pursuing. We try to give a flight demonstration that speaks for itself.
The Blue Angels. They are men who have achieved a perfect display of aerial artistry and precision flying, achieved through the kind of dedicated teamwork that is the tradition of naval aviation. aircraft designed and built by private contractors for the Navy must pass the Board of Inspection and Survey trials before final acceptance. These trials are held at the Naval Air Test Center, Patuxent River, Maryland. The test pilot is the key individual in these trials. His evaluation of the airplane determines whether an airplane performs its intended mission safely and efficiently. There is a continuing need for the specially trained test pilot to do this testing. The United States Naval Test Pilot School, located at the test center, meets this need. It equips a selected group of naval aviators with the academic and technical materials necessary for the exacting test of testing the Navy's new aircraft. This is where the academic groundwork is laid. Calculus, thermodynamics, plane and spherical trigonometry, progressions and infinite series, Cartesian coordinates, and aerodynamics. At the test pilot school, no distinction is made between pilots of varied backgrounds. Regardless of experience, they study the same subject, and they will perform the same flight test in the same airplane. This pilot has 4 years of experience with multi-engine seaplanes. Here's one that put in 6 years with carrier-based fighters. The helicopter is this pilot's specialty. Here is a light attack man. Different backgrounds, different airplane types. But they all have one important thing in common. They have been carefully selected from the various fleet squadrons. Each one must have a sound engineering background, for he must obtain his own flight data, reduce that data in accordance with the academic instruction he received, and present the results in report form.
Buffet boundary is determined in this test merely establishes the aerodynamic limitations of the airplane's turning capability. This limitation may be imposed by the buffet itself, by the lack of elevator effectiveness, or by an accelerated stall.
After the morning classes are over, the pilots check their flight syllabus board. This is their flight schedule for the day. As a general rule, the afternoon test flights are based on material covered in the classroom immediately prior to the flight. In this particular buffet boundary test, the pilot is interested only in establishing the aerodynamic limitations of the airplane's turning capability. After a thorough ground check of the airplane, the pilot is ready to perform the test. An experienced Navy test pilot flying a parallel course in a chase plane will act as an observer during the test flight.
Hello, Sea Kettle 906. This is Sea Kettle 20. Report when ready to start test. Over. This is 906. Roger out. Sea Kettle 20. This is 906. I'm going to start with a couple of windups through 25,000. Mach 0.8. 100%. Ready to commence first flight. Over. This is 20. Roger out. This is 906. On setup, Buffett. 3.8.
Over. This is 20. You're in the ballpark. Stand by for wind up at Mach 0.9. Over. This is 906. Roger out. The actual flight completed, the problem is still not solved until the pilot completes his flight test report. To accomplish this, the pilot must reduce the data he has obtained during his flight, and when necessary, plot the results in a graph form. The flight report that the student test pilot prepares in his training status is preparing him for the day when he will be writing NATC reports as project test pilot. There are seven principal sections to the flight report. Section 1, conditions relevant to the test. Section 2, purpose of the flight. Section 3, the scope and method of the test. Section 4, results and discussion. This is essentially the body of the report, and information contained here is derived directly from the data obtained during the flight. The data is both quantitative and qualitative. The quantitative aspect is factual. The pilot is working with numbers. The airplane might meet all of its mathematical specifications, yet fall short, in the pilot's opinion, in its response and ability to perform its mission satisfactorily. The pilot must use his own body, his own nerve center, as the criterion in this case. The airplane merely enlarges his sensory field and serves to extend his hands as well as his feet. The pilot must ask himself, would I be willing to fly this airplane into combat? Sure, it reaches the speed specified, and the normal acceleration attained is identical to the figure given by the contractor, yet that Dutch roll is impairing the airplane as a gun platform. There is nothing in the manufacturer's spec that covers this. This is pilot opinion. This is qualitative analysis. The student test pilot, now possessing the quantitative data in figures and the qualitative data in his own opinion, is ready to discuss the results of his flight test intelligently and effectively. The remainder of the flight report deals with the pilot's conclusions, recommendations, and the enclosures from which he obtained his figures. The report completed, it now is placed in the mill, and the student test pilot has chalked off one more test flight. Before the student test pilot has completed the course at the test pilot school, he will have performed 50 such tests. Meanwhile, the flight report is carefully screened for accuracy of data, soundness of the pilot's judgment, and whether the report has been prepared according to professional standards. In most cases, the reports will be satisfactory. In some cases, outstanding. And every now and then, an unsatisfactory report crosses the desk. Errors in reporting must be corrected in a rewritten report. However, errors in technique or obtained results require the student to go back upstairs for a repeat flight. As a part of their training syllabus, the student test pilots are given a tour of the four main test divisions at the Naval Air Test Center. Each one can expect to be assigned to one of these divisions upon his graduation from the test pilot school. The purpose of these visits is to acquaint the student with the specialized billets that are available for the graduate test pilot. Here at the Armament Test Division, the armament systems of the airplane are evaluated. To accomplish this, both ground and air tests of every weapon that can be attached to, hung from, or fired by a naval aircraft are conducted to ensure compatibility with the aircraft and its fire control system. Electronics Test Division determines the suitability of all electrical and electronic components of new airplanes. To do this, a series of checks and inspections are supervised by the project test pilot. The first one is the ground check. Many minor defects can be detected at this stage, such as improper insulation and wire routing. The flight phase of the electronic test is next. Here, the project test pilot determines the suitability of the equipment to perform in view of the airplane's mission requirements. As in all of the other test divisions, the project test pilot makes his final report, the detailed analysis of the equipment that has been assigned to him for evaluation. Flight test is another of the four test divisions. Its job is the evaluation of the airplane in terms of stability and control, airplane and engine performance, carrier suitability, catapult takeoff, and arrested landing. Service test. It is the job of service test to find out at the earliest possible time any major defects in the airplane affecting its service use in regard to maintenance suitability, flight safety and reliability, tactical and all-weather suitability.
To fulfill these requirements, service tests subject the airplane to the usage it would receive during the first 300 hours of operation within a fleet unit. These flights are undertaken in all types of weather and simulate actual combat missions, including full armament and maximum load conditions. Service test encompasses many specialized departments, such as the aeromedical branch. Here, the clothing and survival equipment required by present-day high-performance airplanes are tested and evaluated. After completing their tour of the four test divisions at the Naval Air Test Center, the students once more resume their course of studies at the Test Pilot School. Fundamental dynamics, jet aircraft engines, aerodynamics, and data reduction. In conjunction with the increased load of academic subject material, the daily test flights take on a more complex pattern. Lateral directional stability, lateral control effectiveness, and high Mach investigation. The Officers' Club at the Naval Air Test Center sets the stage for the official culmination of the 8-month course. It is at this ceremonial dinner that the graduation certificates are presented to the pilots. This is what they have been working toward. This is the reward for their 8 months of intense study and grueling test flight. One of the evening's highlights is the presentation of a trophy to the outstanding student. He has earned this award through high academic achievement and flight proficiency. Graduates of the United States Naval Test Pilot School have gone on to distinguish themselves as aviation leaders wherever they have been later assigned, and in many instances will fly the same aircraft that they had previously evaluated for the Navy at the Naval Air Test Center. Their jobs as project test pilots for the Navy are among the most rewarding the service has to offer. Have the responsible job of buying our future fighting machines and will contribute immeasurably to the fighting proficiency of the fleet.